Dit is nieuwsuitzending nummer 194. En die is geheel gewijd aan twee personen. De eerste is Greg Szymanski. Dat is iemand van, hij is Joods volgens mij. En Szymanski, dat is een Poolse familie, of familienaam. Je kan hem vinden tegenwoordig onder Greg Anthony. Ik zal hem er eventjes bij pakken. Waar hij nou precies zit. Hè? Even kijken. Snel zijn. Ja? Doe gewoon zo. Greg. Oh. Ik heb hem hier trouwens in mijn bladwijzers. Oh, die heb ik niet moeilijk te doen. Deze. Deze website die heet arcticbeacon.com. En daar kan je al zijn werk vinden. Investigative Journal. En zijn laatste plaatsing is op 14 april dit jaar. Ik kijk hem eigenlijk elke dag. Kijk ik of hij weer wat nieuws heeft. Hij doet ook elke dag een uitzending. Wat ik niet wist, was dat dit interview, dat ik kende uit die tijd, het is gepost in 2012, 23 januari. Dit interview heb ik heel goed beluisterd, meerdere keren. En ik wist toen nog niet dat het van Greg Anthony Szymanski was. Toen niet, nu wel. Dus het lijkt me goed dat jullie hier even naar gaan luisteren. Het is wel in het Engels, maar ik hoop dat je een beetje kan verstaan. Als er hele moeilijke woorden komen, dan grijp ik wel in. Dus nu gaan we even luisteren naar Greg Anthony Szymanski. En zijn interview met een vrouw en die noemt zichzelf Svali. Dit wordt heel interessant.
You're listening to the Investigative Journal. I'm your host, Greg Szymanski. Two hours with great interviews all the time. We get into the news behind the scenes that the mainstream media refuses to cover. What a shame. Let me just update some things before I tell you who my guest is today. I've been promoting it all week, and we're going to get deep inside the family, the order, the Illuminati, today for 2 hours. And you got to stay with us from the beginning to the end of this interview. Okay, we're back. It's 8 minutes after the hour, and we're going to get deep inside the Illuminati, the family, the order. We have a guest that was involved with this group, born into it for over 30 years, and her name is Svali. Svali, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Well, it's nice to have you here, and I know you don't give radio interviews, and I really want to thank you because I think it really does help the American people understand about this secret organization that you were born into. So I guess before we, I guess we can just start from the beginning and tell us right from the beginning you were born into this from wealthy parents, and tell us about your training in this group and when you were a young child and then up into your orientation at the Vatican. Go ahead.
That's a pretty broad area, though, Greg. I mean, that could take hours, if you know what I mean.
Yes, but do it, you know.
Ik ben even een beetje aan het pielen. En hier kan je meelezen. Dat het toch Engels is. Hier zitten we nou. En ik zal meescrollen, ja?
Today I've been promoting it all week, and we're going to get deep inside the family, the order, the Illuminati, today for 2 hours, and you got to stay with us from the beginning to the end of this interview. Okay, we're back. It's 8 minutes after the hour, and we're going to get deep inside the Illuminati, the family, the order. We have a guest that was involved with this group, born into it for over 30 years, and her name is Svali. Svali, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Well, it's nice to have you here, and I know you don't give radio interviews, and I really want to thank you because I think it really does help the American people understand about this secret organization that you were born into. So I guess before we, I guess we can just start from the beginning and tell us right from the beginning you were born into this from wealthy parents, and tell us about your training in this group and when you were a young child and then up into your orientation at the Vatican. Go ahead.
That's a pretty broad area, though, Greg. I mean, that could take hours, if you know what I mean.
Could just outline it for us.
Yeah. I mean, I was born in a group. I was born in Germany, came to the U.S. very young, and basically went through all the training that the group, all members of the group do undergo training to different degrees, depending on the role. By the time I was a teenager, I was a youth leader, and by the time I was 22, I became the youngest member of Leadership Council in San Diego County. And at that time, I was a head trainer. I was the sixth trainer. I eventually moved up to the second position. Mm-hmm. And when I was 12, I had mentioned with you the ceremony at the Vatican, that they right. really do make all leadership in the group undergo at some point.
Now, basically, when you were growing up, I remember you told me that you were instilled at a young age, you were born to a very wealthy, well-to-do family, you moved
yes.
back to the States. You were told at a very young age you were special, you were chosen, correct?
Well, they tell everyone in the group that they're special and chosen. And in fact, that's one of the things that made me very cynical when I was older, is that, you know, I mean, you will never meet a person who's an Illuminati who's not been told and programmed for years that they're special, they're the only one that can do things for quote-unquote family. But I was told, yes, you know, I would do great things for family one day. And the reason why, I guess, I can filter some of this with objective view is I know what my role in the group was, and it was over quite a significant number of other people. So I don't evaluate my role or specialness within the group not so much by what I was told, but by what I did.
So you reach the age of 12, and then you're told by your parents you're going to an induction ceremony in the Vatican. Can you
yes.
tell us how that happened and what occurred at that ceremony when you went there?
Okay. This isn't easy to talk about, as you know. When I was 12, I was flown over to Germany, and I was at, I'll call him the German father's house over there, and there was some preparation for a few days beforehand, and I was told that there would be a very important ceremony, and it was considered a sealing ceremony at that point. And basically, I was told a little bit about what I was expected to do during the ceremony. You know, when we got there, we went to the Vatican. There's underneath the Vatican, there's a large room that I described to you when we talked before. It has 13 catacomb chambers leading into it with and what they do is they, as you go down these steps into the room, you can see that it's almost circular, and so they're all around it, and they bring out the mummies from the catacombs, and they set them beside each one, and they say that's the spirits of the fathers watching over the ceremony. And during the ceremony, there was a large table in the center of the room. It was on top of a huge golden pentagram, and they had a ceremony there. You know, they...
Okay, now how many other children were with you being inducted into the family or the order, as they call it?
There were two other children at that point, but there were several adults, too.
Okay.
See, the church also brings in adults to swear their allegiance, too, just so you know. I was told, and I don't know if this is true, but if you're going to rise to a certain position within the Catholic Church hierarchy, you do have to go through that ceremony as well.
Okay, so you're down in this room with, your parents weren't present.
No. The German father and the French father were, yeah.
Okay, and at that point, tell our listeners what you witnessed.
Well, there was a table. It looked like dark glass in the center of the room. I mean, it was made out of stone, but it was very shiny and dark and black. And it may have been something like obsidian or onyx, I'm not sure. You know, I'd have to, that's the only time I've seen stone like that. And it had, around the corners, it had like these gold, I guess, channels that you know, collect fluids. And little Boris was in the center of the table on drugs. I think he was drugged because he was very quiet. He didn't move or say anything during the ceremony.
This was a little 3 or 4 year old boy.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then they continued to go ahead. They continued to do a child sacrifice.
Yes,
right
they
in front
did.
Of you.
They did. Yeah. I told you about that before. Yeah.
Now afterwards, unbelievable experience for a youth. I mean, for a 12 year old. I mean, what went through your mind? I guess when that happened. I mean.
I was terrified. I mean, I was absolutely horrified. I can't describe the terror you feel when you go through something like that.
And do you remember the words they were saying as this was going on?
The man was in scarlet. He was speaking in Latin. And basically, he was saying, you know, please accept the sacrifice, you know, on this day. But then, you know, and then he said the sacrifice will seal the ceremony. And then he did it. Again, I was so terrified that... Have you ever been in a situation where your heart's racing, but you can't do anything, and so you're just kind of sitting there, and you're kind of like fading in and out?
Hier stop ik hem even. Dit mag duidelijk zijn. Waar zij het over heeft... is het offeren van mensen. En zij zegt dat zij daarbij aanwezig is geweest in het Vaticaan. Dat is bij Rome, weet je wel. Dit zegt zij. Dit is uitermate zorgelijk. Want zij is het sprekende bewijs van het feit dat het dus echt waar is. En iedereen die meedoet aan de katholieke kerk, de KKK, en die middelste K is van, dan moet je zelf maar kiezen, dat is dus waar. En ons land, onze regering, die sterft van dit soort lui die dit oogluikend toestaan. En nu mag jij je angst gaan voelen met je Mark Rutte of je Jan-Peter Balkenende of waar heb jij vorige maand op gestemd. Jij stemt dus mee met dit soort dingen. Een mooi plaatje, vind je het niet? Echt een prachtig plaatje. Hè? Dat je het even weet. Dit is geen geintje. We laten het nog even uitspreken tot het laatste stukje. Want dit is maar 1 van 10. Hè?
Well, you know, I can remember as a youth being frightened, but I don't think I've ever
imagine your heart rate going up to about 220. You can't move, so you're kind of shaking, but trying like not to show it.
Mm-hmm.
And it was horrible. And I keep thinking inside, I can't wait, I can't wait. I mean, you don't say this, but inside you're just kind of saying over and over, I can't wait this over, I can't wait this over, I can't wait till it's over. Afterwards, the man in scarlet, he had a huge golden ring on his hand, and he came over to the center of the room, and he had each of the people that were swearing that day, I had to go forward and kneel before him and kiss his ring and swear my allegiance to the new order, to the new world order, until my death.
Now, and at that point you are escorted out.
Yeah, after the ceremony was all over. I mean, the other people also did theirs as well. You know, they had to swear their allegiance, too.
They were the same age as you?
The two children were, but there were also three adults that went forward and did the same. And afterwards, we were told, may the same to you or worse occur should you ever break this oath.
Moya? Ja, ik zal... deze link. Ja, trouwens, ja, je ziet het nou ook wel staan. Je hoeft alleen maar Svali te typen. Voormalig lid van de Illuminati. En dat is een 1 van 10. En het hele ding, dan heb je 2 van 10, 3 van 10, je kan het zo vinden. Als je het wil horen, wat deze vrouw, deze persoon overkomen is. En waar die rotzooi toch vandaan komt. Het is een mooi gedicht van Wim T. Schippers. Waar moet dat heen? Hoe zal dat gaan? Waar komt die rotzooi toch vandaan? Nou, jullie weten het nu. Je kan nu niet meer zeggen, wie hebben dat niet gewoest? Wie hebben niemand naar die periwinkel luisterd? Want je hebt wel naar mij geluisterd en nu weet je het. Weet dat deze mensen die dit soort dingen andere mensen aandoen, dat zijn jouw vrienden niet. En ook je vijanden moet je lief hebben, heeft Christus Jezus netjes gezegd. Maar dit zijn dus niet je vrienden, want die doen aan menselijke offeringen. En ik weet ook uit mijn buurt van iemand die ik persoonlijk ken, die is er ook bij aanwezig geweest. En zij zei tegen mij, ja, in eerste instantie waren het alleen maar kinderen, maar daarna zag ze een adolescent en die was ook gedrogeerd. En die ging er ook gewoon aan. Ja. Gezellig, hè? Dus dat soort mensen. En nou, over 4 jaar mag je weer stemmen. Nou, ik zou willen stemmen, want Geert Wilders zegt van meer of minder Marokkanen. Ik zou zeggen, we gaan stemmen over meer of minder mensenoffers. Meer of minder. Lijkt mij belangrijker dan het gezeik van Geert Wilders. Ondanks dat ik niet boos ben. Maar dit is wel interessant, vind je niet? En op zijn hamburgers zag ik tjus en daglieverds.